Hi, my name is Greg LeChemenot, and I work for Keysight Technologies, specifically in the group that produces sampling scopes, commonly known in the industry as the 86100 DCAX. And today I'd like to talk a little bit about how we can configure a DCA to do PAM-4 measurements. And when we think about configuring a DCA to do PAM-4 work, there's really two things that we're concerned about. How do you configure the hardware in the DCA to be able to accept a PAM-4 signal? And the second thing that we worry about is, how is it that we actually make the measurements on the PAM-4 eye diagram? So first, let's talk about hardware. When we're configuring a scope to make a measurement, we often ask, you know, what bandwidth do you need to make a measurement? And the DCA is capable of several different bandwidths depending on the plug-in module that you put into the mainframe. But essentially, we've got plugins that do 20 gigahertz, 30 gigahertz, 50 gigahertz, even up to on the order of 80 gigahertz bandwidths. What is going to be appropriate for your PAM-4 measurement? Well, when we think about a PAM-4 signal, for example, take a PAM-4 50 gigabit per second signal. The data rate, 50 gigabit per second. But the key thing in terms of bandwidth for the DCA is to think in terms of how fast that signal is switching, or what the baud rate is. So a 50 gigabit per second PAM-4 would be a 25 gigabaud signal. So 25 gigabaud has a fundamental frequency of 12.5 gigahertz. If we were to try to look at the third harmonic of that, we'd be on the order of 37 gigahertz. Even up to the fifth harmonic, you're a little bit above 60 gigahertz. So in terms of configuring a bandwidth in the DCA to make that measurement, we have a lot of flexibility and plenty of range to make those measurements, even up to 50 gigabit per second. In the optical space, they're also going to be doing PAM-4 modulation at 50 gigabit per second. But the way bandwidth is defined for optical measurements has historically been a little bit different. For example, if you had a 10 gigabit per second NRZ signal, the bandwidth of that was set by what's called a reference receiver, where the bandwidth is 75% of the data rate, 7.5 gigahertz. For a 25 gig NRZ signal, we had 75% of that, 19 gigahertz of bandwidth. What's going to happen when we go to PAM-4 in terms of optical reference receivers? Well, the standards haven't defined it yet, but what we anticipate is going to happen is that, just like we described with electrical signals, that it's not the bit rate that counts, but rather the baud rate. So a 50 gig NRZ optical signal would have a baud rate of 25 gig. The reference receiver for that, we'd expect, would be roughly 75% of that baud rate, which would be 19 or so gigahertz. Effectively, what happens is the very same reference receiver that we used for 25 gigabit per second is likely to be the reference receiver that would be used for a 50 gigabit per second PAM-4 signal. So in terms of hardware channels, then really the hardware that we have today for NRZ signals is going to be applicable to the PAM-4 signal. There are certain measurement scenarios where clock recovery is required, and in a sampling scope, that is done in hardware, not software. So we've got different scenarios. We have external accessories that do clock recovery. We have modules that have clock recovery built in. What would we have to do to change that clock recovery hardware to work with a PAM-4 signal? It turns out, not much. The hardware responds to edges. The edges come through in a PAM-4 signal, similar to the way that they did in an NRZ signal. Really, the only difference there is that we have to tell the DCA not what the bit rate is, but in this case, the baud rate. So the range of our clock recovery system will go to 32 gigabit per second for NRZ and effectively 64 gigabit per second for PAM-4, but we have to tell the DCA, in that case, what the baud rate is, which is, for PAM-4, half of the data rate. Finally, in terms of making the analysis on the PAM-4 waveform, that's also quite simple. Essentially, what we have to do is give the DCA a sort of a slightly modified personality, a new measurement suite that is PAM-4 aware. And with PAM-4, there's essentially a license that we install, as well as a firmware upgrade, gives it a new set of PAM-4 measurements. Many of the PAM-4 measurements that are made on that eye diagram are similar to what was done on the NRZI, things like eye width, eye height, except that if you notice here, instead of an eye width, there are three eye widths. There are three eye heights. So when you press the eye width measurement, it reports three values. Also, as the standards have developed, there's some new measurements that are specific to the PAM-4 signal. We've been trying to be involved in all those standards committees, evolve and adapt as the new measurements are required, and those have been built in and are up to date with our PAM-4 analysis capability. So the bottom line is, if you're going to be encountering PAM-4 measurement needs, the DCA is ready to go today. The hardware is applicable as it stands. Just add the new measurement capability, you'll be good to go, ready to make PAM-4 measurements. So thanks for your time, and good luck with your PAM-4 measurements.